about me. Our next talk is actually from a colleague of mine. And he will talk on his progress he made on his virtualization interface for multiple VMMs. So here's Alexander Petru.
Thank you. Welcome to my presentation about microkernel virtualization under one roof. Outline of my talk looks like this. I will give short introduction and the motivation. Then I will go through several kernel interfaces, looking at the common features and the differences. And based on that, I will try to discuss or to show how such virtual machine interface of all the kernels can be harmonized in a way, so that we can on top run virtual machine monitors which are portable across kernels. If you today look at the off-the-shelf virtualization solutions, then you will see that they are written of complexity. For example, if you look at Linux KVM, there you have a monolithic operating system running with virtualization extensions. There's no isolation between your drivers or the subsystem in the kernel. Or if you think on DOM0, on Xen, it's a huge Linux kernel running there in, and all your virtual machine monitors, your QEMU instances have to trust that it's working perfectly fine. That's a million lines of code you have to rely on. But actually, application for virtualization call for trustworthy solutions, but this somehow complexity defeats trust. There are, of course, alternative approaches around. One way to go, not the only one, but one way to go is use a microkernel with virtualization extension for hardware-assisted virtualization and build from the architecture point of view something trustworthier system. How does such an architecture look like in principle? So I took Nova here, for example, so you can replace it in theory with other kernels. What you need first is you need, of course, a microkernel, which is quite tiny. This has also the features to run as a hypervisor. Then on top, you need some user-level environment. There, your drivers are running in well-protected from each other in own protection domains. And of course, you have native applications on top and some resource management stuff. For this talk, relevant is that you have some virtual machine monitor. Together with a hypervisor, you can drive your guest operating system, your unmodified guest operating system. The nice thing in such an architecture is that the virtual machine monitor, you can have multiples of them, so not the same implementation. They can be specific to your guest operating system if you want to optimize for low code or for security reasons. So you have some, you can play a bit. Taking from this picture, you see that we need a microkernel, we need a user-level environment, and we need virtual machine monitors. And the GNU operating system framework is such a user-level environment. It consists of more than 100 ready-to-use components. So you have native drivers at the bottom. On the bottom left, you have low complex resource multiplexers for network, disk, graphical user interface. So I'm talking about something like 1,000 lines of code, not about million lines of code. Then we have support for several kinds of libraries. You can even use your GNU software. And the main interesting thing is that this user-level environment, which is specifically designed for microkernels, supports already more than, we support 8 kernels. In the middle, you see some of them. The nice thing about it, I think like 2 years ago, we even got to the point that we have a unified API for all the kernels. So that means for some specific hardware platform you are talking on, you develop your GNode component once, you compile it once and link it once, and then it will run on all the kernels immediately. You don't have any recompilation step or adjustment you have to do. It just works. Why this is interesting? Yeah, if you want to build some general purpose OS, when you imagine that you have to package all the components, all the software for each specific kernel again and again, it is quite takes some effort. And with this step, we actually have, for example, for x86, we have just to build it once, to package once, and it will run on all the kernels. Regarding virtualization, we support already several virtual machine monitors and like VirtualBox and Soul, but I will come to this point later. When looking at the kernel, so that's a current one, the 8 we support in principle. Actually, 5 of them are capable to run unmodified, also have hardware-assisted virtualization features. On the one hand is the Nova Micro Hypervisor, where my machine currently running is on. Then we have a kernel called base hardware, so HW typically called, developed by Gnode Labs. Then we have SL4, as you have heard beforehand. We have Fiasco OC support, and even we support Linux to some degree. When we look at the inventory of the virtual machine monitors we have on Gnode currently, you will see that for our own kernel, so for HW, we have some custom implementation, mainly used on ARM machines. Thanks to the MUEN separation kernel project, we have even x86 support for our kernel. So originally, it was just designed for ARM. Together with that, we can run Windows 7 on MUEN with our own kernel. And here we use a port of VirtualBox 4. On the other hand, we have the Nova Micro Hypervisor, which is running on everything which is x86. The nice thing about it is that it supports already multiple vCPUs, 30-bit, 64-bit guests. And the action point here is that we have already support for 3 different virtual machine monitors. So you can run them all in parallel. So you don't have to decide on one. Depending on what you want to run, you can choose. The question now was the unified API, what I was talking about, is working for all Gnode components which are not virtual machine monitors. The virtual machine monitors currently are directly built against the kernel API. So that means so you cannot move it easily to SL4 or Fiasco OC. It's not possible at the moment. And the question was, can we do it? And what does it take to get to this point? And that's what I want to talk about now. In the beginning, we said, OK, let's focus on microkernels first and then on x86, because there's a crosscut is the biggest. And let out Linux for the moment. So Linux KVM would be also a nice thing to look into it. But for the moment, we want to have the microkernels running. So the virtual machine monitors of all of the microkernels for a specific platform. And the approach is simply that we take the interface we have from our own kernel, where we have a good experience on ARM and also on with together with the MUEN separation kernel, and extend it to this degree that we can run Nova, SL4, and Fiasco OC with this interface. So now I would like to go a bit through the kernel interfaces to see the differences. Beforehand, I just want to make a short describe how such a virtualization event looks like in principle. So when you have once you have your guest operating system running, you will at one point get some exit because the guest is doing something which is maybe privileged or it touches a virtual device. So the hardware will cause an VM exit. The hardware will then transfer some of the state to some specific region called VMCS on Intel. And the kernel then, the task of the kernel is to look up whom to deliver this event, so who takes care about it. The micro hypervisor will not do it. So with each guest operating system, a virtual machine monitor is associated. When the kernel finds the specific thread, which the message will be delivered, it will also find some shared memory region between the handling thread and the kernel called user thread control block. Via this user thread control block, you transfer some of the state from the VMCS, give it to the virtual machine monitor. The virtual machine monitor looks into it, decides what to do, and to emulate things or whatever. So this is a principal flow in general. Now I would like to go a bit through the differences. For the Nova hypervisor, it looks like this, that the state is transferred via the so-called UTCP, which is attached to each thread. The layout of the UTCP so is agnostic regarding whether you're running on Intel or AMD, so you don't see the differences in the layout. And the other thing is, if your virtual machine monitor is clever enough, it even can specify which state should be transferred to the virtual machine monitor, so you don't have to get ever the whole state. When looking on Fiasco OC, there your handling thread has also a UTCP, but actually there you set up another shared memory page between kernel and virtual machine monitor, where the state from the VMCS or VMCP, if you're running on AMD, is copied. On Fiasco OC, the full state is copied ever. And the layout of the VCPU state actually is not agnostic regarding Intel and AMD. So this is a difference. On SL4, they decided to go in the third direction. They have also some shared memory per thread. It's called IPC buffer, not UTCP, but it's semantically the same. When you create a VCPU, you set up some VCPU state also in the kernel. But they decided that it's not shared with the virtual machine monitor directly, but instead, when you get an VM exit, you get a fixed set of registers via the IPC buffer transferred, so 17 registers. If you want to have more, you have to make a synchronous syscall per item in the VMCS to ask for the rest. And when you want to enter, want to resume, you transfer 3 registers, which is fixed. And when you want to transfer more, you have to make synchronous syscall beforehand and fill each item one by one. This I have looked up, so something like 60 registers in the VMCS are relevant at most, so it means it's quite an overhead you can produce. So now we have seen how the state is copied forth and back, and now the question is how the control flow works. So when you get an exit on the Nova hypervisor, the kernel sets up for you an IPC call. That means your handling thread gets a synchronous call, and as soon as when it replies, the VCPU gets running again. On Fiasco OC, it's the way around. You have a thread in the virtual machine monitor. You assign some VCPU object to it. And if you have done this, then you can make a blocking syscall called VM resume. And then the blue thread in the virtual machine monitor is blocking until the point when the VCPU exits again. And for SL4, it's the same as for Fiasco OC. They have a thread, you attach some VCPU object to it, and afterwards you are allowed to call a blocking syscall. So it's semantically the same as for Fiasco OC. When we're looking on the kernel developed by Gnode, it's done more non-blocking and asynchronously. So when your VCPU exits, the VCPU stopped, the kernel sets up some asynchronous notification. The next time the virtual machine monitor thread will be scheduled, the signal will be delivered. And when you want to resume the VCPU, you make a call to the kernel, which is, however, non-blocking. And so that means this virtual machine thread is ever ready to do something else in the meantime. It's not blocking at all. So now we have seen the common features and the differences. Now the question is, how harmonized interface can look like? How we can support it on Gnode in general? Or is it possible? The main idea here is that the virtual machine monitor should just be a normal Gnode component. Then the question is, what is a normal Gnode component? A Gnode component is designed in a way that it should be driven by events. So it's in order to implement easily state machines. So that means when you start a Gnode component, you have a thread which is called entry point. And so the only job of this thread is to register for any kinds of events he is interested in. And afterwards, you leave the scope. So you're not blocking or not spinning or something like this. You leave just the scope of your initialization. And then you wait to hope that something happens. And then when an event comes in, you get ready. Only during this event or this state transition, you do actually something useful. And as soon as you leave the handler, you are ready again to handle something else. And such events can either be synchronous incoming remote procedures calls or asynchronous notification. From the handler point of view, you don't see the difference, actually. For a virtual machine monitor now, such VM exit, such a VM event should just be another event source. So we don't want to do any special about it. Also, if you want, if some I/O is ready and must be, and for example, a network arrive for your guest, this I/O event should also just be another event source. We don't want to do any special. Of course, we want to have a kernel agnostic API. And the vCPU state on this interface should also be agnostic regarding whether you're running on Intel or AMD. It should not matter. So we don't want to expose it to the normal developer of a Gnode component, so of the virtual machine component. What I have told you now in a picture maybe, when you start a virtual machine monitor, you have your entry point, which registers, for example, for you want to have timeouts or you want to get networks packets delivered to your VM. And when you create vCPUs, you get just a notification that something happens. This picture was mainly so that you can build single-threaded virtual machine monitors, which is nice in order to have to don't care about logs and stuff. But of course, you can also go multi-threaded if you have multiple vCPUs. If you have multiple physical CPUs, you want to put the vCPUs on the physical CPUs, then you can have, of course, spawn several entry points. That's also possible. Now, regarding the kernel-agnostic API, so what we do on Gnode is that the Gnode base library is part of the dynamic linker. The API for this shared library is, as I said, kernel agnostic, so it's fixed. The actual implementation of the library, of course, can be then kernel specific. So that means for depending on which kernel you're running, you get another LD libso, but the interface is the same for this. So that means all our components are typically dynamically linked. So, and yes, we put this interface just in the base library, and there is, then we have some freedom to implement it kernel-specific. How this interface looks in general from an abstract point of view. So on Gnode, when you want to have a service, you set up a connection. If you get this connection, you get back a capability. So you have a session. This implicitly sets up your address space for the guest, which is empty in the beginning. Then you can populate it with creating new CPUs, getting access to the state of the guest, attaching memory, so backing the virtual machine monitor with some memory. And then you have a specific handler class where you actually register for this event for an exit. And then you can let run or pause a vCPU. And the calls are actually non-blocking. So in the picture, it looks like this. So when you start up your kernel, the first task is core. Then you have some management component in it, which spawns a new instance, virtual machine monitor in that case. When the entry point starts, it sets up a connection. So it asks the parent, I want to have the service, please give it me. So then you can you have policy attached, which can be enforced. Then you get this connection to the service, get back a capability, and then you can directly talk to the service. So that means on Gnode, when you have a VM session, it means you have a connection to some service. So and via the service, you can create CPUs, attach memory, all the operations you have seen beforehand. And whenever an exit happens to some of the vCPUs, the exit can be will be delivered directly to the virtual machine monitor. What you see from this picture here is we have some freedom to decide where to implement stuff, which depends heavily on the kernel and the kernel interface and how nicely we can hide the special things of the kernel. So in this picture, this task is kernel specific, it must be, and in the library here is the implementation is specific. And for Nova, Fiasco Scene, SL4, the delivery of the exits are, for example, goes directly to the virtual machine monitor. In theory, we also can deliver it here and then get a notification over there, but currently it looks like this. Just to give you an idea, so on the service side, just to get your virtual machine running, we need something like 200 to 400 lines of code. On the client side, for Nova and SL4, we need something like 500, which is mainly copying the state forth and back of the vCPU. For Fiasco, it's a double amount, mainly because of the fact that you have to do for Intel and AMD it twice, and you cannot nicely abstract away. For our own kernel, you see that's actually just a coarse rules wrapper, so there we don't implement anything currently. Now I would like a bit go through the control flow stuff. It's the pictures you have seen beforehand for HV, for our own kernel and Nova. So the direction, how the call went on an exit, how is looks similar. And in more detail is, so when you get an exit from your vCPU, your kernel gets running, and on our own kernel, we sets up a signal, so an asynchronous notification, on Nova it's a call. Then the handler becomes running. The fact that it's a synchronous or an asynchronous notification is not relevant for the handler. It just becomes running, it got its event. When you then decide to resume the execution on our own kernel, it's just a non-blocking asynchronous notification or syscall to the kernel, which is non-blocking. On Nova, when you actually say, I want to run, the implementation just will remember its effect. And as soon as you leave the handler, this handler class, the IPC reply will be done. And if you said run, then the kernel will take care to resume the vCPU. And if you said not run, we have some kernel extension where the vCPU will not be resumed. So the next topic is, for example, you have a virtual a device model which programs some timeout, and the timeout fired. So you get some event, your entry point is non-blocking, is running. So the first thing what it does, it calls pause to get the vCPU halted. On Nova, it's a recall syscall, and the nice thing is both are non-blocking. Then at one point, the VM gets stopped, and as soon as this happens, again, you get your IPC call on Nova or a signal on our own kernel. And then you look at the states, write to the right registers that you want to inject and interrupt, that the timeout happened, and yes, and you can just resume it. So the both kernels are quite similar, and we, the Nova-specific parts, we could nicely hide. When looking at SL4 and Fiasco C, so they have the same control flow direction. So you have a blocking thread, thread which makes a blocking syscall to resume the vCPU. This makes for us life complicated because on Gnode we don't want to have blocking syscalls. The kernels actually provide mechanisms that you can cancel this ongoing blocking syscall. But we decided in the first take not to to look in detail into it, so because it caused some headaches how to get it nicely hidden on API level. And so the current workaround is that we spawn per vCPU you set up in the kernel also an extra handler thread in the virtual machine monitor. What does it mean? Whenever you create a thread, actually you create your vCPU and you also create a handler. Why we are doing this, so that the entry point just can run the non-blocking call. The handler does actually the blocking call. And that means immediately after this run, this entry point is still ready to do something else. So it's non-blocking. So for example, it can't just run another vCPU via the same thread. Regarding an I/O event you want you inject, for example, you have again a timeout. You instead of the entry point will make on the API level will make a pause. Actually, what now that's happening that is that we go to the kernel when we have set up this asynchronous notification objects on SL4 on Fiasco is the interrupt object, and what actually happens is that this blocking call will be cancelled. So that means here we pause, we immediately return, the entry point is ready to do something else. It's non-blocking, which is good. Afterwards, this ongoing syscall will be canceled. You return, you get the fact delivered that you got canceled because of something. And then we set some, we set up just with Gnode primitives, a normal asynchronous signal, look at the states, want to inject some interrupts, and then you go back to the handler, and the handler does again this blocking call. So with this apps, with this workaround, we can nicely abstract this this blocking call away. So now we have seen how we in principle get this harmonized, this interface. Now the question is, yeah, how is the virtual machine monitors better we can actually run virtual machine on top. Of course, we start first with just simple unit tests. So you start with some simple instructions, where you know that they will exit when you instruct it, then you just check the control flow. When this was working, you add several vCPUs. Then you put several entry points on several CPUs and have multiple vCPUs running and getting this unit test running. After some while, the Nova and Fiasco OC, it was running quite nicely. It was no big deal. But with SF4, we hit some issues. The first thing was, more or less by accident, we called this VM enter syscall on a thread which has no vCPU attached. And what happened, the kernel folded just away. So there was a null pointer dereference in the kernel, and the kernel died. So we patched this array, notified the SL4 developers, and they acknowledged it's a bug. So it's not just that we did something wrong, it's just a bug. The next issue was the test began running, and we got error invalid guest states of SL4. On Fiasco OC and Nova, it was running fine, but on SL4, it was not running fine. After some time, we recognized, oh, yeah, we are running in 16-bit mode, and they actually have no unrestricted guest support. So the hardware has the support, but the kernel does not enable it. So we looked through the Intel specification and enabled it in the SL4 kernel, because we don't want to change the test just because SL4 can't do it. The next thing was when we had some specific case where a vCPU was just spinning and was not exiting. And as soon as this thread becomes running, the whole system starved, blocked. Nothing happens anymore. Yeah, we have some top utilities where you see the utilization. And afterwards, that the top utility put to a high priority level and the vCPU below, we saw that it's running on 100% the vCPU. And all the vCPUs next to it on the same priority level was not scheduled anymore. So we looked through the kernel. It must be a bug. Yeah, we found the place. So we reported this to the SFO developer, and they acknowledged it. Yes, it's a bug. They missed some state checking in the scheduler. Finally, we were done. The tests were running. We were happy. Now we just wanted to wrap up and run our normal tests on SL4. And the kernel will just not boot on some machines. And then we noticed, as soon as you enable this feature, this kernel cannot be used on CPUs which has not VTX available. This is, if you think about a general purpose OS where you want to use this kernel, it's quite not going to work because you don't know the target machine actually. So we patched this out because this is we don't want to provide several kernel compilations. So at the end of the day, the toy virtual machine monitor was running on all three kernels. It also works on AMD on my private home machine for Fiasco OC and Nova, but SL4 has no support for this. So the next thing was, actually, we would like to run real virtual machine monitors, not the toy stuff. We have Seoul and VirtualBox 5 as port. I decided for Seoul first because it's much, much, much smaller than VirtualBox. If you run in trouble, you can easily debug it, of course. Mainly, I ripped off all the Nova-specific parts, replaced it with a new interface, got it running after some days on Nova. And then the idea was, so now it must just run on SL4 and Fiasco OC. It turned out, no. Yeah, it took me several days, which sum up to 2 weeks, to get it running. On the one hand, because I did things wrong. On the other hand, there were difficult differences. Where I have some backups live, but I cannot go into detail now. The final conclusion was that we need a further patch for SL4 and one tiny patch for Fiasco OC to get it running. At the end of the day, all three kernels were running with the Seoul virtual machine monitor. That means we have a Linux VM running with network, even with SMP, but not for SL4. As soon as we enabled SMP for the Linux guest, the kernel just dies again with some fault in the kernel. This time I did not investigate it. The next step was actually we want to have the VirtualBox 5 virtual machine monitor running, because with that you get support for Windows 7, Windows 10, Ubuntu, whatever you like to. And this is currently work in progress still. So the VirtualBox binary is already kernel agnostic, so it boots up the same compilation. It starts running on Nova quite fine for some simple Gnode VMs. So I use Gnode as VM because it's easier to debug for me if something goes wrong. And for as a full fiasco already, it comes up to some point, but something is still not correct. But we will find out. Besides the unknown remaining challenges, the known remaining challenges are still that the VirtualBox 5 port requires access to its FPU state. Nova has this access in principle, which is currently not missing in the virtual machine interface, so we have still to edit. But for SL4 and Fiasco OC, I'm quite not sure whether it's supported. At a quick look, it does not look like this, but maybe I'm wrong. And on SL4, actually, there's no 64-bit guest support. That means you will not get your Windows 10 running at all. So the final conclusion. So in the beginning of my tour, when I prepared or started with the work, I was quite skeptical. That's why my subtitle. Now it looks more like it could be possible. Of course, there are some restrictions depending on the kernel you are using. You should be aware of it. And the roadmap now is that we will finish the VirtualBox 5 adaptation, so getting all our VMs we are currently running on Nova back again, so the same functionality. And if we done, then depending on the time you want to invest in SL4 and in Fiasco C, we will also do this. When this then gets upstream, the next idea is that our own kernel then it's the time to add to our own kernel also a virtualization extension for x86. Yeah, and the same approach you in principle also can apply to ARM or RISC-V, or this is but optional. So the benefits of this work are that you get portable virtual machine monitors across the kernels, and at the end of the day, actually the Gnode user has the ultimate choice regarding the kernel. So depending on the stability of the features of the kernel, you can choose within some minutes, you can choose another kernel and run the same compilation, same virtual machine monitor and the same VM on Gnode. Okay, that's all from my side. Thank you. Any questions? Yeah.
You inevitably run into situations where the handler thread is on a different CPU than the vCPU, on a different core. So
yeah.
You need to deliver the event cross core. Do you know how much performance overhead that causes?
For the Nova case, it's not possible. So your question is, in principle, yeah, I don't know the overhead. But for example, for the Nova kernel, you cannot do this cross core. So that means that if you have a vCPU running on some physical cores, you have to have your entry point on the same physical core.
So you keep the one-to-one mapping.
Yeah.
Not the end-to-one.
Yeah.
And you also keep the synchronous notion that the vCPU basically pays for the entire handling of the of the request.
Yeah. No questions?
After the previous presentation, the previous question is how come you find all these bugs, problems in SEL4, and what was not formalized then that was spotted?
The question was how did we find the bugs in SEL4, and what was the post?
How was it not formalized in SEL4?
And why it was not formalized by SEL4? The actual point is that typically they don't verify everything or every configuration, especially this virtualization extension for x86, they did not verify it, but probably they will do and should do. Sounds good.
Via mailing list or open an issue on GitHub,
yeah.
We're open
Nice to hear.
So I have a question regarding the address spaces of the various components.
Yeah.
In particular, in light of things like secure and computer virtualization from AMD and things that are coming like this, where one is will not